In this video, I'm going to talk about the process for creating design options for your clients. The first step is to develop your plan as far along as you can that will be a common basis for all of your options. Let's say your walls are in place, maybe your windows are in place. Some of the elements may change, maybe your cabinet island, maybe some of the cabinets, but as much as you can, you want to develop that plan that will be common across all options. Once you've completed that, you can then save your plan as option A, B, C, etc. Then you open up each one of those options and you would refine it. Figure out what the colors, the materials, the textures, the layout of the plan. And then when you have completed it to the point where your client makes a decision and they've chosen one of the key options, I like to then save that back as my main plan. And the reason that I save it back as the main plan is because if I've been using that plan and send it out to my layout, it won't break any of the links. I'm going to go through and I'm going to show you a couple of ways that I've created some options. There are several ways that you can do it. I'm going to show you a couple of techniques that I use. Let's go in and take a look at a few. One of the techniques I like to use are using dynamic defaults. In this example, let's assume the kitchen is designed and the client's happy with the configuration. They're undecided about the options for their cabinets. After interviewing them, you've identified half a dozen options: door style, hardware, countertops, etc. You can then come over, select one of these cabinets. Let's grab this base cabinet, and you can set that as your default cabinet. There's a edit toolbar button down here in the lower section of your screen. When you apply that as the default, it will go through and make all the changes into the kitchen. Key to that is leaving your cabinets as your default cabinets when you're doing your design work. You place another cabinet off to the side and you customize it. In this case, if I set our wall cabinet as a default cabinet, it will make the change. Now you're going to notice as I make a few of these changes, not everything is considered a dynamic default. Take a look at the crown molding. Crown molding is not yet a dynamic default and will not change when you make these changes in the program, so you may need to use a material eyedropper, pick up the color off of the black, and then apply it. But it is a quick process to be able to generate different views and again set your cabinet configuration, set it as a default, make the change, and it will then apply it to the entire design. Once you're finished, you can generate renderings, and I've been able to generate a handful of renderings just by doing that same technique in the design. Very quick way, I can pass these off to the client. They can see what their options might be and to help them make their decision on the best kitchen for them. I've opened up another plan and it's isolated to just the island. And it's the same concept as I had just shown with the entire kitchen, where I can grab a cabinet, I can set it as default, grab another cabinet, set it as default, and it will then apply it to the majority of the objects in the plan. It won't apply it to everything that's not dynamic, but it will apply it to everything that is dynamic. An example might be moldings. If I had an edge profile, you'll have to use a material painter. Let's grab and place another cabinet. Now when you place another cabinet, I'm just going to grab this one, slide it off, and you want to customize this and provide a fourth option. Let's slide over and let's make some customizations to this. In the library, let's begin by changing the door style. I'm going to come down and I'm going to select one of our cabinet manufacturers, and I'm just going to make a handful of changes in here. Let's change and apply the door style. Let's go in and grab the matching drawer and apply that. Next, I'm going to go in and I'm going to apply a color combination. And if I scroll down, you can find their wood species and finishes. I'm going to come and I'm going to find a neutral finish or natural finish, and let's apply that in more of a stain mode. Let's assume that we like that, and we'll use a material eyedropper and apply that to the rest of the box in the object mode. The final thing is hardware and countertop. Let's come and find a countertop manufacturer. We'll come down to, here's Cambria. We'll grab this material and apply it on there. And then the final item will be the hardware. I'm going to go up into our bonus catalog. I'm going to scroll down and find our bonus cabinet hardware that you can download from the 3D library. We'll find a few poles. I'm just after something fairly simple. We'll apply this pole and just replace those. So we've made a few customizations to this box. And if you zoom back out, let's close our library. Come over here. I can now click on this cabinet, click on Make as Default, and you can see the changes apply to that entire configuration in a pretty quick way. And now I can easily provide the client with the different renderings they need to choose with these different islands. Here's another thing that I often will do to try to isolate and create the design for the client. This island configuration is one of three. And what I can do is I can create the different islands, block them, add them into my library. In fact, this particular island is a block. When I select the island, notice the bounding box all around the island. I can actually use this tool called Replace from Library. It's an edit tool in the lower edit menu, and when I select this tool, I can choose to replace the selected object in the room, in the floor. Not really relevant since this is an entire island, but you could use this to change out all of your pendant lights, all of your seating, and it's a quick way to swap things in and out. When I choose the library option, and I browse down to where I've stored these in my library, notice that I've called them A, B, and C, select the option A, I can easily swap that out for the other island. It's a quick process. This allows me to create the renderings for the clients, and in the examples I have here, you can see the color combinations and islands that I've been able to generate. This makes it an easy process for the client in their decision making to be able to see exactly what they're going to get. There may be times when I set up three different options off to the side of the design, and I can use the material eyedropper. Come over here, pick up the gray, and in this case, what I might do is change the scoping of the material painter to do everything in the entire room that is white can now be gray. Notice it didn't change the brown because I only replaced the white color. You can easily come over and let's change that to the particular object, and now you can apply it in that way. And the way I do this is I usually will set the same color combination for my cabinets and isolate it so my white cabinets aren't using the same white as the baseboard. Notice my baseboard didn't change. So I usually set a specific color for those cabinets. Let me open up another plan. I'll show you an example of that. In this example for this kitchen, I've isolated the color combination to three colors, red, white, and blue. I've added them to my library. Some of them are specific named colors from paint manufacturers. One of them is a mixed color. If I want to apply the red in replace of the white cabinets, what I can do is come in here, click the red color, come over, make sure that my scoping is for the entire plan, click on the white, and it will globally replace all of the white with that red. Again, the key to that is making sure I've isolated that specific color to only my cabinets, because when I'm in this material painter plan-wide, it makes the change on all floors, anywhere that that white color is used in the plan. So the key to that is making sure that it's specific to that object. To apply the blue, come over here, and it's very quick to make those changes, and then you can show the client the renderings and help them make the decision what works best for them. So I've been able to render these out and then send them out to the client. It's not 50 colors in this case, it's three colors. They can see it exactly in their plan. So a few different ways to create your options. Again, just to kind of make sure that when you get ready to start doing your options, you get your main plan as far along so that it's common between as many plans, so you reduce the amount of change that you have to do. One of the things that I will sometimes use is copy-paste hold position between different plans, because inevitably something will come up where you want to move a window and you want to move it in all three. You can move it in one, copy-paste hold position, and move it in the others and reposition it exactly. It also works for perspective cameras. If you notice in these three examples of the kitchen, I have the same view of the camera, and if those were three separate plans, you could get the camera set in one plan, and then you could copy that camera, paste hold position in the other plan, and then you get the exact same view. That way it lines up and the client is able to register that as the exact same thing. And then finally, as I'd mentioned at the beginning of the video, when one of these plans ultimately becomes the final, I typically will then make that the main plan, whatever you're saving it as for the client. And then if that were linked into the layout sheet, I wouldn't have to make any other changes. Have fun making design options for your clients.